Alright, welcome to the start of another spoiler vlog. This is for Memories of Ice, the third Malazan book. I have a whole playlist. It's in the card. I'm not doing a spoiler-free review, so this is also kind of, I guess, my spoiler review. I don't know. I'm just going to talk about all my thoughts, and per usual, I'll probably be wrong like 70% of the time, and don't feel the need to correct me. Especially if it would pull from information from future books. I really don't want to be spoiled. I'm loving piecing together the world-building of this series. It's a great time. So, let's get into it. I just finished part one, because I kind of like check in at the end of each part, and this is like the prologue and The Spark and the Ashes, which is an apt title. Everything's very intentional in this series, right? I really love that. So I'm that far in this behemoth of a book. Like, I swear, a page in this is like 3 pages in any other normal work. But the prologue. Let's start with the prologue. Hot damn. Like, oh my goodness. Up to this point in the series, we've always been hearing about the Talana Mas and the Jaghuts and, like, I don't know, this old thing in the background and how they were, I think they're both elder races. I know the Tisti Andi are as well, and there's one other that I can't pronounce, but that we see in this section, I think. Unsure. But regardless, we know that they had this battle, and we know that part of this triggered the Talana Mas to become immortals, and we know that's also why the Jaghuts are pretty much extinct, I think, to this point. And we see, like, the end of one of their wars in the prologue, and it's so compelling and cool. Has this, like, warren that, like, I still don't know a lot about. Like, we actually were in a place with it, with some other characters, with, I think, Tok the Younger, who's back! I love Tok the Younger. I didn't think he was dead for a second in Gardens of the Moon. I mean, so far, when deaths happen, they are, they do hit you, but the resurrection is a huge part of this world for the most part, so I always kind of feel like there's always a chance, but there's still consequences. Like, I do feel like the consequences are very good. But yeah, and then I think, oh, I could be wrong, but I think we meet this dude who was a tyrant, and we have these 3 elder god people, I can't remember all their names, one of them we met in Gardens of the Moon, basically come to punish him, and they curse him, and he curses them, and I think their curse upon him is what makes him the crippled god. I think he's the crippled god. I'm not 100% sure, but I'm pretty sure the prologue is where we meet this aforementioned crippled god. I don't know what he has to do with the, who are we fighting, the Panion Damin, which seems to be our main antagonist for this book. I'm unsure. And then, of course, we have, like, the ascendant for Earth, Burn, who's been sleeping, and it seems to be, like, the apocalyptic world stakes is that she's being poisoned, and there seems to be no good answer. Because we have Kaladin Brood, who has the hammer, who I think can use the hammer to kill her. But that could be horrible. But also, if he doesn't kill her, it's also horrible. I think one of those means there's no magic anymore. So it really seems like the definition of rock and hard place. And I'm curious to see how these, like, people pan that out. Like, Quickbend, who I think is the youngest of our very immortal, powerful people. Like, I don't know if Quickbend's immortal, but Quickbend has, like, all the warrens and all the tricks and the complicated history. But, like, between him and the other Tisti Andi and, like, other big immortal players, like, I'm curious to see their part in that, how that pans out. Because that's, like, our big nebulous thing so far. But, like, on the ground, on Genobacchus, we're all converging to remove these kind of, I guess, fanatical people who are, like, using these undead, which I think part of it is that, like, other elder race. At least I was looking in the glossary, and I can never say the name. But it's got all these, they seemed like really creepy things, like the way they were described with like the back legs and the claws. It's the Kichane Chimale, I think, is what was used. I could be wrong. I didn't like go through my notes with a fine tooth comb when putting these together, but they were so creepy when we were with, so one of our groups of people is a group that we don't really know, but I love that one of the characters' name is Gruntle. In my household, we've been talking a lot about the word disgruntled, which, you know, means upset, and, like, that gruntle, which doesn't sound like to be content, means to be content. So I just love how Steven Erikson names people sometimes. I just think it's really funny. So we have that band of people with this priest, and we meet up with other necromancers, who I think one of the names is very familiar to me, must have been in Gardens of the Moon, but I don't have, like, a big light bulb moment with them. But we have this whole, like, necromancer group with them, and we're also with another tribal region, and they have to fight off that race, which I think has to do with the Panion Damin, as they're going to the city that we're all going to converge onto, which starts with a C. And I can't remember it, but everyone's converging there. That's the point. And so I think that's why, like, this is the spark in the ashes. Like, we are we're getting ready to start something. A lot of setup, a lot of re-meeting people. This is the first time where I really do feel a lot of Whiskey Jack's personality when we see him in a lot of these closed door meetings about how he's going to make sure no one hurts Silver Fox, which Silver Fox, there's a lot of complexity in Silver Fox and how, like, you know, she's sucking the life force of her mom, but it's also like not her mom, but it is her mom. But you know what I mean? Like, Silver Fox is many, many things. Primarily, it seems to be Tattersail, but there's all of this idea of warring souls, which we already had in the first book with Sari, between Cotillion and the old hag and whatever her name was. What was Sari's name before? The Fisher Girl. I guess now her name is Apsalar. But, you know, the warring souls thing is something that's used quite often. And then Perrin. I wrote poor Perrin in my notes like 5 times. I mean, I think it's interesting because Perrin in the first book, I think if told he's the master of the deck of dragons, I think that's what it's called, right? Deck of cards or something. If he was told that in the first book, I think he would have taken it in stride. He was very much a go-getter in the first book, very sassy, like no matter how powerful you were, he could stand up and talk with you and, like, I don't know, feign being an equal. But then he goes through everything in the first book and here he is now. And he is just burdened and doesn't want it. And I think it makes sense with everything that's happened. But man, like him going into the Azath house and like figuring all of that out, like the connection between the houses and the deck of cards and how this is how the magic system evolves, right? This is how we get new cards in, old cards out. The fact that he saw a place that used to have like a pantheon and it's dead, like, I love that the magic system of this world is not stagnant, that it evolves and that we're seeing lenses into how this evolution works. It's really cool. Is there anything else I wanted to say about Perrin other than hashtag reluctant chosen one, which, you know, I think there's a lot of things that are kind of subversive or more different lenses that we use that we don't typically see in the fantasy lens. Like I was talking to someone, like, this is definitely a world where you definitely get to see the average human or person more than the powerful. Like, we do get perspectives of someone who's very powerful, full of magic, but an average, like, Gruntle is a main perspective. He's just a mercenary, at least right now. I don't know if he'll be anything else, but you really do get, like, boots on the ground perspectives, which I think is really cool. Let's see, do I have anything else for Silver Fox other than, I guess, she's the leader of the Talana Mas for now, which is cool. All right, Rake and Brood had one of my favorite conversations, and that's just like a thing. There were so many quality conversations from like the little guys level to the upper level that I think really is a good way of doing the character work and world building execution, which normally I would not be as good with, but for some reason I get a better sense of the atmosphere and the people when we have these banter conversations, whether it's around a campfire, whether it's in a room where we're having one of those table discussions about like the war and what's going on. I like a lot of them. I like the humor in them. They all land pretty well for me. Were there other ones particularly that I cared about? I don't know. But yeah, so right now we've got there was like this throwaway line that all the wars are connected. And then I was thinking of Deadhouse Gates and the Whirlwind. I'm like, how is the Whirlwind connected to all of this? And where are we going? And I know we're going to be going somewhere really interesting, if not in this book, you know, throughout the entire series, which is just so compelling. And other things. Oh, things I'm still thinking of and looking at is like spirits. So we have this magic system with these warrens, but we also have these spirits. Are they connected? Are they separate forms of power? And how that works. So we've had a couple different groups of people like the Rivi and I forget their names from the Deadhouse Gates. I can't remember their name right now. But we've had a lot of spiritual stuff and I'm wondering how connected they are to the warrens, to the Azeth, to the deck of cards, you know, all of these powerful forces of nature and how that converges and how that's going to overlap. I'm really interested in that. And I think that's it. I'm really compelled and I'm excited to see what happens next. What is the next section even called? It is called Hearthstone, which is a really great card game that I love playing on my computer, but I don't think that's what that means in this context. So I'll check in once I finish that. Okay. I have finished part 2, which I still don't know why it's called Hearthstone. I looked up what Hearthstone means. Has something to do with home. I didn't get a lot of home vibes, but I'm also like sometimes not all there. But a lot's happened. I have like so many notes. So let's see how briefly I can summarize all of the thoughts going through my head. I will say there's like this predictable sort of path that I go on with a Malazan book at this point where like the first part's super intriguing, sets the scene. The second part continues the setup, but I'm less intrigued, and then it just kind of bulldozes to the end. That's what's happened in the first two. It's what I'm predicting here, which means although a lot has happened, this part felt a little disjointed to me in that, like, even while I was trying to compile my thoughts, I just was like, oh yeah, and this happened to this person, and this happened to this person. And it all does go together. But, like, as I was trying to recollect my thought, we were just hopping around everywhere. So this book is definitely more like Gardens of the Moon than Deadhouse Gates, which is fine, because I liked that one more. It just makes it hard to remember what's going on. So I first want to talk about Capuston. I don't know how to pronounce that city. It's the third section's called that. It's where we're converging. That is where we are going to presumably fight amongst all the things. And we got to meet the Grey Swords, who I believe worship Fenner, so that was cool. The politics are complex, they seem like. It seems like the Grey Swords are doing their own thing, and they're connected to the Prince, who this seems kind of like a constitutional monarchy to some extent. Maybe not exactly, but there's a council, and he doesn't have control over the council, even though he's Prince. And the council seems to be everyone represents a god, except the one for Fenner is, like, kind of not the real one, but the real one doesn't want to step up. That's what I've kind of gotten from it. And then there's the Barghast, who come through a lot in this section. And apparently they have some old remains there. And that's going to be the thing, I guess, that's going to get the rest of the tribes to come help in this battle, I guess. Yeah, that was a whole thing. And then, let's see. Oh, there's just a whole bunch of undead showing up. Like, we have, I guess, two of the founding races are undead creatures now. I talked about it in, like, the previous section. But yeah, that's a thing. And I like that the Talana Moss are like, we'll fight these other undead because we hate that they're here, but we're not fighting humans. So that's nice. Now we have some stuff with elder gods, which there was a really cool world-building reveal. We have, I think his name's Cruel. I don't know how to pronounce anything with as soon as there's an apostrophe in it, like, my brain, like, freezes. But apparently the Warrens are his body or his blood. I think that's really cool that, like, actually all of these Warrens that we have, like, up to this point kind of talked about as distinct entities with certain qualities are all part of a whole, which I do think really does make sense. But not only are they a part of a whole, that whole is kind of the life force of this elder god. So I wonder, like, if it's already been implied and I've missed it, or if we're going to really learn in some more solid way, like, how this came to be. Has it always been a part of it? Like, because we are in a world where everyone can ascend to godhood and the elder gods are just an older version of this, how did this come to be? Like, the creationist origin story of this place is so interesting. And I really like this book so far in that because it's so focused on the past, you know, the memories of ice, I am getting more tidbits of that. Oh, and there's so much more with, like, the crippled god and how he's forming a house of change. So we have this Jaghut Herald, and then he recruits Kellor, which I missed when we first met him, that he was the guy in the prologue who cursed all the other elder gods. And, like, he had the kingdom he kind of, like, destroyed. I totally missed that. So he's the guy from the prologue, and now he's been recruited to the House of Chains. So that's going to be interesting. He also really, really doesn't like Silver Fox and wants to kill her. And I'm like, sir, no, don't do that. I really like Silver Fox. And then, of course, we have Lady Envy, who's the daughter of, like, one of the older people, the person who made the sword. And she seems really powerful. Not only does she know Cruel, and that's how we, like, learn stuff, but we have gotten to hear about some of the destruction she's caused and kind of seen through Talk the Younger's eyes stuff that's happened. So those are all, like, the big, powerful players in what they're doing. Talk the Younger. There's a lot going on with that poor boy. If I'm not going poor Perrin, I'm going poor Talk the Younger. Like, in what's kind of hard for me right now is they're not the same person to me, but they have similar personality traits, and they're both going through tough times, and both have a lot of Chosen One energy that I don't get them confused, but I would like them to become a little bit more distinct in their characterization. Hopefully that'll happen soon. Just because, you know, the characterization is always so brief when it comes to Erikson works. So I think sometimes, you know, when you put your own stuff into making a character, they both just have very quippy one-liners. They both have to deal with a lot. I do think Perrin having to deal with leadership is, like, shaping him and evolving him into something else. But him, with his whole wolf eye situation, then we've, like, gotten to see stuff through some wolf eyes, and I guess maybe he's working on ascending to, like, there was this beast throne that the seer was mentioning, because he gets to meet the seer, who's creepy and has Jaghut powers. Why does everything have Jaghut powers? Like, from what I could tell, in the past, the Jaghut were kind of peaceful things that just, like, lived by themselves, and then the Talana Moss didn't like them. That's all I've put together. And it just like I'm wondering what happened. Like I just need more history lessons. That's something I would really love. And like, why did he split up with Lady Envy and them? Like he briefly says it's because he would have died if he was with them. Maybe. I mean, they are such powerful forces and he doesn't consider himself a powerful player. I did like his line about how like, why are you making me a bow and arrow? I have no depth perception. Although it's kind of like I think in Deadhouse Gates, where we had the priest of Fenor there, who like, I don't know if it wasn't with eyes, he was just actually blinded, but like he had two hands, even though one wasn't a hand anymore. I think it's like a similar thing there, where like there's magical qualities to the eye that doesn't work, maybe. So yeah, and he's in a bad situation. There's some reptilian beast hugging him to death. And like, yeah, it doesn't seem like a good time. And through him, we get to see the, I don't know how to pronounce this word, Tenescuri, which are basically the fanatic followers of the Panion Domin, and it's a lot of cannibalism. It's a lot of cannibalism. I don't think I've ever felt this grossed out since I read, I don't remember the name of the whole series, but it's the Prince of Nothing series and the second trilogy. There's some gross stuff that's similar to that, which if you've read that, you know. But yeah, and like, I don't know. I'm kind of glad we only had like a brief insight to that. It's just like, way to make a force that I really want to see like die. I really don't want this person to win at all. All right, what else do we got? Bridge burners. We got the bridge burners origin story. That was fantastic. Again, just loving all the little history lessons I'm getting in this book. That was fantastic. And they had this like section of fireside banter. I need more banter. I think this book is lacking in banter in comparison to Deadhouse Gates so far. It has cooler world-building elements, but like the banter is not at the same level. But I loved seeing them. They were just, you know, shooting the shit, just having a good time. It was fantastic. And then we have Trotz, and he has to basically fight. And if he doesn't win, everyone dies. And then both him and the person he fight basically die, except somehow, even though the Warrens, I forgot to say the Warrens aren't working right now. That's inconvenient. But the healer almost can't heal him, but it works out because Quick Ben was taken by the Braghest spirits. And that's another thing I think I mentioned previously, like the spirits and lost memories and afterlife as a theme in general has been very interesting in this section of the book. Like, especially with, I think that's who I want to talk about next anyways. I can't pronounce her name. It's Silver Fox's mom, Mabe, maybe is how you say it. And she's so scared of death now, even though in the previous section, she was wanting to end her life. But that was, she said, back when she thought she would get to go with her spirits. And now she feels like she knows the truth. And it's a whole thing. And whoa, she like ends this section and like, it's something with like a dragon. Oh, what do they call it? It's a Talana Mas bone caster. I'm blanking on the name. And so it seems to imply to me that she has a connection to the Talana Mas, and I want to unpack that. And I also want her and Silver Fox to be okay. Like, it's really like taking to extreme the metaphor of how like parents put all of their energy into their children. Like, it's an extreme metaphor. And let's see, more stuff. Whiskey Jack. Him and like Carlot just decided we're gonna go be lovers. I just thought that was sweet. A little out of nowhere, but also sweet, especially because they were having like one of their heart-to-hearts about battles when they were on opposite sides of the war and like kind of how in that war things were still like had a certain code, which obviously we're in a situation where there's not a code. They are fighting cannibals. I don't know if they know that yet, but they are fighting some undead and cannibals, and it's gonna be a time. And is there anything else I want to say? Basically, questions for the next section. I still need to understand who the crippled god is. Is it like that fall? Like, there are things from other planets, which I like that kind of like otherworldly aspect, like the Tistiandi. And I know at the beginning we were talking about a fallen god. Is that the same as the crippled god? I don't know. I want to know more about the Morrenth and the Braghest and the Talana Mas, because there seems to be connections. Like, there seems to be like a starting point, and then there was a divergence. And I'm very curious about the evolution and the history of the world, if that's not clear. And then we've got Gruntle, who I didn't talk about a lot, but he's like changing up his role. I also still love that his name's Gruntle. Silver Fox didn't get as big of a role here, but I don't know. She's a fascinating thing. She has like 2 to 3 souls within her, and is connected to my boy Perrin, who I like, who I already said is like dealing with leadership. So I didn't forget to say that. And then there's Treach, who we see die through Tok the Younger's eye, but we still have, I think her name is Pikes or Piker. I don't know her name. She's a bridge burner. She has like these things on her arm that won't come off, and they're for Treach, So obviously he's still in power, and we had the Grey Swords talking about the first heroes person, who's Treach, who's also another kind of ascendant of war. So I'm waiting to understand that. I'm intrigued. I'm listening. I want to see that come through. So these are all of my rambles of all of the things that I chose to remember from this section of the book. And now I'm going to go read the next one and see what happens. Presumably there's going to be a siege and chaos. All right, I finished part three, and woo, it was both like a great part, but also a very difficult part to get through. It had a lot of lulls for me, a lot of moments that I was curious about why we were in certain perspectives that like didn't detract from the scene, but also made it hard for me to get through certain parts. But man, the big moments were huge moments. Also, my cats decided to wander around, so if you see like a tail at any point, that's why. So, I mean, obviously the first big thing is the siege in the city, which, whew. Siege scenes are always like so tense, and that is definitely brought through here. And like, couple that with Gruntal's like, not ascension, but like becoming I think it's the first sword. I think that's the name in the hierarchy. I can't keep track of the shields and the swords and the Detreants or something. But he is basically part of the Tiger Ascendance, which is like the new war ascendant thing. And like, that transition was really interesting and well done. Like, I don't know, I just like enjoyed having that also happen with the siege. And then everything that happened with the Grey Swords. Oh, the betrayal, the last stand, how the old shield basically helped the Grey Swords take up the new wolf god sort of thing, or wolf pair, I guess. All of that was so much. And I'm really curious what's going to happen to this person. And I think it's like a real testament, again, like similar with Deadhouse Gates, where I have only just met the Grey Swords this book, maybe even just in part two. Like, I haven't spent that much time with this like company of fighters, but I care so much about them, and like this one character in particular, and like where their story goes, and like justice for them. Because man, that like mass council with like the different people who are like the high priest, they did them dirty. And like, I'm not convinced anyone in that council is like not corrupt. I mean, that kind of makes sense, right? So you have that whole Grey Swords thing, and that was like phenomenal as well, or at least really tense. So that's like the whole siege. And then like that kind of twist that all the peasants who are like, you know, these cannibals that we've been with for the first half of the book are going to be basically enlisted into the Grey Swords was definitely not something I was expecting, but also I guess kind of makes sense. And kind of one of the last things with this was that whole encounter with Anamander Rake and Whiskey Jack. And that first dead child thing, oh, the whole thing with these people and the Seers thing is just so gross. It's just so disgusting, like how this kid was conceived. Yeah, but like that whole situation where they had to kill all of these mothers like really quick or else they would have power again. And at first he was using his sword that brings people in and they can never leave. And Whiskey Jack's like, no, that's too much. And so then he had to perform the executions in front of everyone. And just like that whole thing, it was a lot. Lots of huge moments. Let's see, other things that came to mind. Oh, apparently Tok the Younger is the other part of the wolf thing. Like, so the wolf he was traveling with when he was with Lady Envy, I guess, is the other half. And then he's part wolf, which he like, you kind of get, because when he was in the Chaos War, and the first scene we have is like a wolf with him. So you like kind of knew there was another spirit in him. So it's not like super shocking, but it kind of happened. And yeah, you know, it's it even makes it weirder that Tok the Younger got away from Lady Envy and them. Because shouldn't he have like, at that point, supernaturally maybe been drawn to her? I don't know. But like, that'll be interesting, assuming he ever gets out of the bad situation he's in, which is also just like, ugh, I just like cringe when I think of it. Cause like the way he's described, he's so mangled right now. He is not in a good place. So that's really interesting though. Ooh, Silver Fox, Tattersail, Ninth Chill, whoever, this whole entity. She does her second gathering and as such, not a temper tantrum, but like they're asking for something very reasonable. And she's like, no. And she's obviously really upset and feels really abandoned. And I feel like I wish we have gotten any Silver Fox perspective up to this point. Like, we used to get Tattersail and Gardens of the Moon, because, like, I really want to know what's happening with all of these personalities interacting with each other and why there was this strong response. Because it really, I mean, it came out of nowhere for me, it came out of nowhere for Croup. Like, I think to some extent, it came out of nowhere for Silver Fox that she would say no. And not only no to letting them die after they finish killing this one Jag-Hutt entity who is the seer, but like also not letting the like old wolf equivalents go with the Wolf Clan people where they belong. And that apparently has something to do with her mother, right? Like that's what it has to be. But like what? I'm very curious about how that's going, because obviously I think there's a lot of like guilt over taking the life force from the person who brought her into the world and like dealing with that. And I think it has something to do with the wolves, because obviously she's been running, the mother has been running from wolves in her dreams. So we'll see what happens with that, but I was just not expecting her to just, I don't know, I guess I don't know if it was Nightchill or someone else who was more speaking through there, but I'm used to Tattersail being a little more level-headed. And speaking of Tattersail, I guess I should start talking about Perrin, since they are like not an item, but like I think of them together. And I was interested that Perrin and Quick Ben are like, let's let the House of Chains into the deck of cards. And like the logic of, well, if you let them in, they're then constrained by rules, and when they're outside, they don't have rules, and how that's gonna play out. And also how they're just like, I'm done with gods telling us what to do. We're just gonna have this happen. And like right before that scene, Quick Ben was doing so many things with so many of his cool warrens. Like he was traveling through a wall and through the air. I thought that was super fun with him and his little like acorn friend. I forget his name. He's like one of the, oh, Barath. I don't know if that's how you say that tribe's name, but like he's one of their elders who's like trapped into like twigs with an acorn head and can help him with the warrens being poisoned. And so you get to see all the warrens. I would love more scenes like that where Quick Ben just like does all these cool magic things. I thought that was a really fun way of like for once getting like a more like direct taste into how this magic system works. So that was super fun. So, and also that was really unexpected. Another unexpected thing, I think his name's Corelli, being like Carule, like the Elder God. Like, this should have been more obvious, but like when that was revealed, I was like, well, goodness. And then how the Mask of Counselors were like, well, now seriously, you can't be on the councils. And the one girl, oh, I forget her name. I want to say Snotty, but I don't think that's her name. But she was like, really like, oh, is he just like too much of a god for you? And like, someone said something not great to her. I remember commenting, like, well, damn, that's getting a little cold there. So, yeah, and like, obviously, we're now at the point where like, we've handled this one big moment that was a big moment at the start of the book, but now everyone's realizing, yes, we have to deal with the seer, but there's so much more going on. Like, we have the whole crippled god thing and how he's poisoning the warrens. Brood is supposed to like kill Burn, which would have bad consequences whether he does or doesn't, but he in theory has like a third way. Also, these necromancers, we have like two necromancers who have just been like around, not as like comic relief, but like they feel like such a random side story. Like, I'm sure it's gonna all come together. I just learned recently that this last part that I'm about to read and like the ending of a lot of Malazan books are called convergences, so I'm excited to see how it fits in. But ever since we've been introduced to the idea of these necromancers, they've just been kind of gross and like I don't know the point of them. And that still kind of stands, although it does seem like some of the, I think Hood specifically, maybe Shadowthrone, are like perturbed with them. And like Gruntal knows this guy, Buke, who's involved. But I'm just like, what are these necromancers doing? Like, what? I don't know what's gonna happen. So I'm curious in this fourth part, like how much of this issue we're gonna try and tackle. What's going to happen with all of our players? We have so many players. There's so many moving parts. I was even just compiling my notes, just like there's so much I can't even remember, and I know I'm forgetting things that are important. Like I think it's been implied, like something important about Nightshill. Like I don't know who she is. Like honestly, when you meet her in Gardens of the Moon, she doesn't seem like she's that important. But it seems like maybe she's an Elder God. Like she seems really important. I might not be right about her being an Elder God, but there's like. The third person that was there with Kalor, like, I feel like I don't know where that person is in this story, but I feel like I've met her, or it's been alluded to in the pages, and my brain's just not been smart enough to connect the dots. So we will see what happens. But I'm excited. Dive into part four and see what happens with this one. Okay, I finished it. It is done. That was a lot of magic. It was so much magic. Like, everything in that last portion, that last 150 pages, is, like, straight from, like, some action movie. Like, I felt like I was watching a fantasy Malazan version of the last scene in Avengers, and not Endgame, just Avengers, where you keep, like, cutscening to different things. Whoa. So many things. I'm for sure gonna forget things that are worth mentioning, but I will say at first, you know, because when you get to the end of Deadhouse Gates, you get the Coltane scene, and you're just like, ugh, ouch. And you also get the scene with the two friends and, like, the secrets there and how one's a Jag, like, the whole complication there. Like, Deadhouse Gates had, like, things that hurt me. And here, I was, like, invested. I was curious, but I never had that moment. So I was like, is that happening, this book? Is that, like, a thing that's going to happen to me? Like, I was talking to my friend Brittany, and I was just like, you know, I think I like Deadhouse Gates more. I'm not sure. Like, they're all so close. Like, all of the Malazan books are, like, they're neck and neck so far for me. Like, I like them all for different reasons. Like, they each have their different specialties. But then, Whiskey Jack dies, and Trotz dies, and the shield anvil dies. So many people die. And well, okay, I will say that I do think the Bridge Burners and Whiskey Jack, who are in the Moonspawn, which, like, I now know what first in last out means, which is at the end of every one of Andy's videos, which, like, I never knew until I finally read this book. It's like, oh, that's why he keeps saying it. Like, I knew it meant something, but I never knew what it meant. Like, the Bridge Burners, ugh. But when you leave that scene with Quick Ben and Perrin, there's, like, a glimmer, shiny thing, and I would not be shocked if they, like, ascend or something magical happens. Because, like, that's something the series does well, right? It's, like, there are stakes and there's emotional payoff, but, like, there's so much magic and there's so many different ways to, like, introduce people back into the stories, not without repercussions, but, like, you don't ever have to completely lose someone. Like, Tattersail, Silver Fox. Ooh, poor Silver Fox. At least it all worked out. I felt so bad. She, like, she had this plan, and it was just really hard, and, like, the personality disorder is, like, high. Like, it was so high, and, like, her and Perrin aren't a thing anymore. Not that they were ever a strong thing, but, you know, like, that's rough. I felt bad for her when, like, the wolves were gone, and I'm just like, well, you kind of deserved it, but I still feel bad for you. And then Kalor has to go be himself. Like, I know I had the dramatic irony of knowing he signed up with the cripple god, but how does anyone trust that man? Like, I don't know. And speaking about other people who get to come back, Tok the Younger. Oh boy, talk about, like, some trauma. I feel like Tok's gotten such, like, a raw deal, like, this entire series. Like, when you first meet him, it's after the Battle of Pale, he's lost an eye, he's real pissed about it. He makes friends with Perrin, and suddenly he's just blown into a chaos warren. And then this book, he comes out, but he's kind of, like, got a god in him, but doesn't know it's the wolf god. And then, like, I guess decides to go fight with the cannibals as, like, a double agent, which was not smart, but I don't know if Tok the Younger's smart. I don't have a good sense of his intelligence, but, like, I still, regardless, when he was held by that mother, and then, like, the whole thing where he becomes the wolf, and then they let his spirit back, and it goes into the first cannibal child. Oof. That was creepy. It was creepy. The whole cannibal stuff in, like, parts 2 and 3. Incredibly terrifying. I was quite glad this last battle was with, like, these undead sword monster people. It was much more, like, less humans being their worst selves, you know? It was less a commentary on humanity and more just, like, epic, cool, magic battle. At least that's what it was for me. Like, when Moonspawn comes out of the water, oh, so good. So good. And, oh, there was a line when, like, the water was, like, tearing down from it, because this was during, like, very melancholy portions with all the death. So much death. And, like, again, I wasn't expecting to feel things, but I felt things. And in that epilogue, like, I knew Duker wasn't dead. I knew, I mean, we had a monkey, flying monkey thing, take his soul from a thing, and so I knew he'd be reintroduced, but I didn't know he'd be in Darujistan, and I didn't know he would end the story by telling another story, which is, like, my favorite trope. It's, like, my favorite thing. So that was something. I love also that the remaining Bridge Burners got all their money. They went to Darujistan. Piker and, I assume, Blend opened the bar. The book's very coy. I am positive that they're dating, but the book just doesn't straight up tell me, but I am positive they're dating. And the fact that Blend has these magic things she doesn't know about, oh, so cool. And Quick Ben, I mean, he's so powerful every time, but, like, the demons that he summoned with the dinosaurs, so cool. And I think the thing that shocked me the most that I like never picked up on, and I don't know how obviously it was portrayed to me or whatever, is that so at the beginning of the story in the prologue, we have these two Jaghut kids that this T'Elanna Moss takes to this warren that she thinks the Jaghut warren, but it's not. It's like, I don't even know if it's a chaos warren, but it's the rent over Morn. And I thought she put both kids in there, but I could be wrong. And I guess maybe if she did put both kids in there, one got out and that one became the seer. That was the Jaghut. And this whole thing was like his own personal revenge arc. And we get to see that T'Elanna Moss again, who happens to be Tool's sister, which we'll get back to Tool in like a minute. And just like that connection, that like throwback to the prologue was really nice. Like I really liked it because it provided more context for me. Because like otherwise I was just like, are you just corrupted by the crippled god? Which he was, but like there was more to it and it made it a more like human thing, and the fact that there is this forgiveness and using the Jaghut's warren to cool down Burn to buy us time. Because like obviously we're gonna have to deal with the crippled god, presumably in the book called The Crippled God. I mean, don't spoil me, but like I can read titles of books. I'm gonna make a guess there. So like I like how this is like it buys us time. Once again, a complete thought of a book, which like thank you, Malazan, for making my sprints work it. Well, it's not even a sprint, it's like a marathon. I spend so long reading these books. I think this one took me 29 days, which is totally fine, but it's just by the time you get to the end, it's nice for it to feel like you've accomplished something and it was worth it. And Tool's like not the undead version of a T'Elanna Moss anymore, and he's with his sister, and it was so nice. Oh, that scene when he walks off to talk to the younger to check on him, and they didn't know, and now they're gonna be, I think, with the other Rivi who like have to rediscover their stuff. There were just so many nice things. I also loved every scene where Quick Ben's like, pair and draw a card, and he's like, well, I don't know what to do, and it's like always like these stick figure cards. And like, I love how Quick Ben's just very well versed in magic and just like winging it, and Perrin like is still like just reluctantly trying things but like doesn't really want to. It was good. It was good. Oh, in the end with Perrin got some of his sass back at the end. That I was so happy for that. So at the end he goes to the Azaas house in, is it called Finis? I don't know. It's the one in Daruchistan that we see at the end of Gardens of the Moon. He goes in, he sees the Jaghut in there, he's like, I'm leaving my stuff here. I don't want to stay at the inn anymore. I'll be back later, going to the bar. Like, oh gosh, I missed that part of Perrin. But yeah, overall, great book. I think, like I said in other clips, the things I've missed most is the banter. I miss sapper banter. Like, I know we had sappers in this. We had, oh, the guy with his mom's hair. I don't remember his name. He's got the warren that makes all the animals scared, which when they used that with the condor, I knew they were gonna do that, and that was clever. That was good. It was good stuff. But I miss the sappers from, like, the Deadhouse Gates. I don't know. I just. I miss that part of the military humor that I just don't think was like as strong here. Oh, I didn't even talk about Gruntal. Gruntal's just great. I just like Gruntal. I like all the people. They're all so good. I can't believe Whiskey. Oh, the way Whiskey Jack died was just rough, man. It was just rough. Just like the step, and he would have had Kalor, and I still don't know how people trusted him. Immortals are dumb. Immortals do not make smart decisions. That's for sure. I'm glad that Animatterake is like, I will get him with the sword. So, yeah, I think those are all my thoughts. Like, obviously, not all my thoughts. There are so many thoughts, but those are all the ones I can think of right now. And it was great. It was a great time. Another one down. Seven more to go, but they all keep getting longer, so I know I'm not 30% of the way through. But it's fantastic. So hopefully we'll get to House of Chains in the next couple of months, because I think that's the sequel to Deadhouse Gates, and I'm pumped. If you made it this far and you don't have any comments but just want to leave me an emoji, leave me ice snowflakes. Oh please, it's so hot here in Boston. I'm not filming with a fan right now. It's 95 degrees inside. It's like 105 outside. I am dying. So ice, yes, all of the ice. And like, if you liked it, subscribe if you want to, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.